of that, we crop about 80 acres of cauliflowers, broccoli, kale, red cabbage, and green cabbage. We also have a rotation, 1 year vegetables, 4 years pasture. So we've got that animal livestock part integration of it. So we've got 1,000 sheep, 40 cows, and 4,500 laying hens. So a bit different.
Yeah, you are a bit different over there. Also, your soil's quite different over there too. So, look, the other two growers that we're waiting on are Michael Evans from Mulgowie Farms out there at Mafra. And then I'm not sure whether Peter Shadbolt from Scotty's Point will hopefully join us during the afternoon. Once they come online, we'll get them to introduce themselves. And our other panel member is Michael Nash from Agnova. Michael.
Yeah, thanks for inviting me along. I actually run an independent consulting business, advanced invertebrate management. And one of the things I'm really keen on participating today is with changing farming systems, we see changing challenges, and particularly snails and slugs become more of a challenge when you improve your soil. So it would be really great to participate in this panel session today, and hopefully I can add some insights on the problems you may face.
Yep. Thanks for that, Michael. I mean, we specifically brought you on just to have a chat about snails, as they pop their heads up quite frequently. Peter.
Yep.
Got you on the line. How are you going? Hey, look, we're just doing a bit of intro to the growers. Can you just sort of paint a picture of your production system?
Yeah, we're about 20 k's north of Swan Hill up here in up on the Murray River. Our main crops are onions, although we tend to grow more hectares of broccoli and beetroot through the winter now than onions. And we grow a few pumpkins as well. So all okay. Under permanent sprinklers.
Yep. Okay, so that's the panel, and then Michael Evans is going to join us during the webinar too, and I'll get him to do the intro when he comes on board. Just a little bit of how we'll work this. On your right side of the screen, there should be a box, and it should have what will have, Liam, questions, a questions tab.
Yeah.
So if you click on that questions tab, then you can type questions in there. And then I will try and summarise those and ask the panel those questions. Obviously, I have a set of questions that we're going to go through with the panel, but we'd really welcome your questions. So if you can put them in there, and if you want to actually ask the question yourself, can you click the hand raising? Now, where's the hand raising button, Liam? Okay, it's in that little menu down the side there as well. So when you type your question, if you can just click the hand raiser, then I'll know that you want to ask the question. Look, I just want to thank the growers in particular because for contributing here, because they've got no vested interest in actually promoting this. In some ways, it's their competitive advantage that they're giving away, and we're really grateful for them sharing across the industry. Thanks for coming along and contributing. And Michael's probably the only one that wears a vague vested interest in that he's sponsored by Agnova, one of the bait manufacturers. Is that right, Michael?
Yes, they're paying for my time today. I'll try not to name drop too often.
But, I always just make sure that people are clear on where people are coming from so that they know that and can take that into account. I guess myself, Kelvin Montagu, I'm with the Soil Wealth ICP project, which is a levy-funded project, and I hope you're all very familiar with it. I'm going to refer later to the Soil Wealth website as well, where a lot of the resources are housed. Particularly under the cover crop and the tillage tabs. And I think Peter's been having a good look at some of those, judging by the fertiliser bin on your strip-till unit. Right. If you can just maybe just just drop the panel down. Before we start with the panel, I just wanted to paint a really simple picture of why we're interested in cover crops and softer tillage methods. And this is a very simple model. And what we've got is soil organic matter at the center of your soil health. That's the thing that we, you know, typically measure in our soil tests, so we can actually go back and look how we're tracking. It's important in itself, but it's probably more important in that it's like a feedstock into soil biology. So it's the input of food that drives a lot of the biological activity in the soil. And that biology is really important for things like soil structure, your nutrient availability, suppressing some of those pathogens in your soils. So in traditionally in vegetable production, we're pretty hard on soil organic matter. And I typically would say if you can maintain what you've got, you're doing a good job. I reckon now I'd say that you should be thinking about trying to increase it. And when you think of organic matter, it's a fairly simple concept of trying to increase it. On the left-hand side, you've got your inputs. So these are things like crop residues. So if you think a corn crop, then you're putting a lot of residues in. If you're thinking a leek crop like Adam grows, then you're pretty much putting very little in apart from a bit of root left over. And that's similar for sort of carrots, baby leaf. You know, a lot of our crops we grow, we don't put a lot of crop residues in. I'm going around that circle. The next one down is cover crops. And obviously that's where it started as an important way of putting organic matter into your system. We've got a couple of other options. Composted amendments are really important where you don't have the time or the water to put organic matter into your system. Then you can actually import it off the farm and introduce it. And then finally, Jake's a good example of having pastures and animals in his system. So he's got 4 years of pasture to build up organic matter before he goes back into his vegetable rotation. So they're pretty much the only way you can get organic plant material into your production system. On the losses side, then vegetable production is pretty hard as well. The cultivation that we traditionally do is basically breaking down the soil and exposing the organic matter to the soil microbes, which then eat it. And so we can drive it down. I know talking to Peter out at Sally's Scotty's point, you know, he was doing 8 passes before his cropping. He'll tell us how many he's dropped down to. So, you know, that's pretty hard on the soil, doing that much cultivation. And then if you think of, say, something like baby leaf, where your crop cycles are so short and you're still doing quite a lot of cultivation, then, you know, you're really impacting on the soil organic matter. In terms of the other cultivation losses, some of our harvesting methods are pretty harsh. And again, going back to Adam with this, when he's pulling up his leeks, it's pretty hard. If you're doing potatoes, carrots, you know, any of those root crops, it's pretty hard on the soil in terms of, again, it's almost like another cultivation. The other one that's really tough on soil organic matter is the fallow. And why it's so tough is that when your soil is fallow, you essentially got no input, so there's nothing coming in on the left-hand side, but the soil microbiology is still there and it still wants to be fed. So it will be slowly ticking away at the organic matter that you've got in your soil. So if you can shift from fallow and put a cover crop in there, then it's a big step forward to actually improving your inputs into your soil organic matter. And the last one down the bottom is erosion. Probably not so much in veggie production, but certainly in broadacre, you know, those dust storms that we see, and we saw them quite a bit over the last year, then the stuff that blows first is your organic matter. And that's often where your nutrient is as well. So you can lose a lot through wind erosion and also from water erosion. So try and keeping the soil where it is And again, cover crops are really useful at that. So when we're talking today about cover crops and strip till, what we're effectively doing is working on both sides of that equation. We're working on the inputs. We're trying to increase the amount of inputs by using cover crops. We also might be trying to preserve our crop residues a bit more. And then on the losses side, we're trying to reduce it by making the tillage a bit softer and just toning it down a bit. So by combining those two, I think is what we're really seeing some big advantages on, and hopefully they'll come through today. A quick look, you know, cover crops, we've been using them for a long time, you know, a range of them. They've got a lot of benefits, but they've also got some you know, real practical issues around managing it when you're trying to get back into your cash crop and make your money. So this is down in Tassie, cover crops. This is out at Adams Farm. You know, there's lots of benefits. There's lots of different types. You know, in this case, his leeks were just coming out a lot cleaner than prior after the rye corn. So there's some real benefits. So I'm just going to skip through these really quickly. The strip till. So strip till has actually been around for a very long time, and it's really just started to pick up here in the last few years. Down in Tassie, one of the contractors, Joe Cook, got hold of some gear from Sly France, and he's pushed it really hard. And most of their broccoli, their processing broccoli, has gone across to strip till, and it's just spreading from there. And I guess we're sort of really promoting that cover crop strip till combo. You know, various ways of doing it, strip tilling after terminating your cover crop, strip tilling green, lots of options. This is a trial, a demo trial out at Cowra with Mark Heinderinger, who's on the webinar. And if you've got some specific questions for Mark, we'll get him to address them. But this is one where rye corn, sprayed it out, left it over summer, and then in with a cucumber sown cucumber crop, and you know, it's absolutely stunning results. And there's just a lots of little things adding up, you know, water and weed control and soil temperature, all those things, and reducing crusting so that you just get a better crop. Lots of examples. This is another one. I'll also be wearing the hat of, let me check, these two guys, Val and Sam. Val and Sam are out at, just down the road from me in the Sydney Basin. And they were the ones that I started playing around with strip till with about 2 years ago. They've actually got just bought another farm out Bathurst, so they're pretty flat out with that at the moment and couldn't join us. But they've been really, really instrumental in a lot of the strip till stuff that certainly I've learned. And, you know, I learned so much from working with Val and Sam. So I'll have their hat on a bit and be talking about some of the experiences that that they've had. Just to get you up to speed, most of the growers have been using this particular bit of kit, the Orthomen strip till setup. And if you walk through, you can see there's a depth colder. Behind that is some row cleaners just to remove the residue from the strip you're going to cultivate. There's a shank that you can adjust. And you'll see on this one, it's got a fertilizer hopper that the boys put on it. And that basically goes down the back of the shank and delivers the fertilizer in below. I noticed Peter's one, he's put a similar hopper on the top of it, but it just flows in before the coulter, the next one behind, and is incorporated through that way. And finally, there's just a surface, a rolling basket on the back. there's lots of other brands around. Nifty Ag do a very good one as well. And we've had Ben on from up Atherton Tableland, where he farms, and he's the agent, I guess, for Nifty Ag. He's had done a webinar with us, so you can go back and have a look at that. And my understanding is Nifty Ag are just organising a more comprehensive dealer network, so it should be a bit more available. Also, if you're up north, we're working with Darren Zucker from a sweet potato grower up in Bundaberg to look at using strip till in sweet potatoes. So at the moment he's just pulling his hills up for his sweet potatoes. We're sowing a cover crop on top, an oak cover crop, and then we'll terminate that around October and go and strip till November, and then plant his slips in around November, December. So if you're interested in that part of the world, then and give us a yell and we'll arrange. You can come along and have a look at that particular demo. This is actually Adam's adapted strip-till unit. He's got someone that tinkers around in the shed, and he's adapted something that he used for fumigating. So he's got his own built one, and he's also tried an Orthamin. So we'll hear from Adam in terms of what the pros and cons are and what the issues are he's had with the two different units. That's really me done. So I'm going to start asking a few questions. Just make the panel big now. Adam, would you like to just sort of run down where you're up to with your cover crop program? How long you've been doing it? What sort of cover crops you've got? What's the sort of sequencing that you're using?
Yes, so our family traditionally have grown cover crops for 40 or 50 years, really. And in the last 15 to 20 years, there's been sort of more and more demand on producing more vegetable products, and slowly but surely less and less cover crops were grown, and other rotation crops were introduced to grow between celery crops, such as the baby spinach, the rocket, using rocket brassicas and spinach as a bit of a rotation instead of the cover crops. But over time, we were seeing that we're on fairly sandy soils on some of our properties. We're seeing a decline in our organic matter levels to a point where we have sprinkler permanent irrigation. We're starting to see a lot of ringing to the pattern, and heavy rains, we were getting a lot of slumping of our beds, just losing that structure to the soil, basically. So some of our properties have been, we're in an urban area in southern Victoria, and we had the last few years, some of our properties we knew were going to be sold off to housing. So we have been overcropping a few of them with the knowledge that they weren't going to be farmed forever. But the farms we have kept, we've tried to concentrate on every year at least putting one cover crop in somewhere to try and build up that organic matter. And summertime, we use predominantly sorghum crops, and winter times basically rye corn crops. And we were using mustards. We found we had some issues with leaf miner and introducing leaf miner when we were using mustard crops. So we had to more target crops that weren't hosting pests that were problems for our other crops. So winter time has been predominantly rye corn, and summertime sorghum. And we try and do that every year before our celery crops, basically.
Yeah. Thanks, Adam. Jake, over in Mangin up there, what's your sort of cover crop practices?
So because we've got the 4 year or 5 year rotation, 1 year of the veggies, 4 years pasture, our pastures have always sort of been our cover crop. So we generally seed barley, oats, ryegrass, 3 or 4 clovers and some attic. So we've always got about 8-10 way mix sort of going to the pastures as our cover crop. For the trials we did with the strip till, we ended up seeding sorghum, lab, cowpea, linseed and vetch. And we grew that up, probably went 2 metres tall, crimped it, sprayed it, and then strip tilled it, and that worked pretty well. But we haven't actually tried strip tilling into the pasture. I suppose what we're pretty keen on is reducing the pastures from going to pastures to veggies. It takes... that's up to 5-6 passes with tillage equipment just to get paddock smoothed off and soft enough to get transplants in. So yeah.
Yep. Okay. Thanks for that, Jake. Just before I go to Peter, just remember there's the questions you can ask. So if you've got, as the guys are talking, if you want to ask them a question, put it in there and we'll get that passed on. Peter, out Victoria, you know, you're in the hot part of the world. How do you cope with cover crops out there?
Well, I grew up being so proud of having bare ground and looking at all ploughed up and beautiful. So it's been probably the last 4 or 5 years. Oh, look, probably more than that, probably 10 or 15, where we get those big winds and the dust storms where the whole your paddocks blow away. So probably 10 or 12 years ago, we started growing oats just in every bit of spare ground we could, not even really thinking about cover cropping, but just to cover the ground over summer. Water for us is a bit limited, and so the cost of growing a summer cover crop doesn't really add up. So we try and just do the winter cropping and then leave it sit over the summer.
Yeah.
So that's really our cover cropping. It's predominantly just oats. So I have mucked around with a few mixes, but I've just been using oats just because I can grow the seed ourselves and it's cheap and we can, get it out there fairly quick and manage it fairly well as well.
Yeah. So when would you normally terminate though, and just let the stubble sit there over summer? Is that what you do?
Well, I try, and if I know I've got a crop of, say, onions or brock going in afterwards, I'll try and grab it before it seeds. But sometimes I might even cut it for hay, but I'll leave a bit of length. The contractors don't leave in a bit of length in it, but I sort of might try and leave it 6 inches high or something, you know, and so just there's a bit of cover there over the summer. And then might be just working it in, like, say, January, February, ready for the onions or brock.
So that sounds very similar to what Ed Fagan did with up in Cowra there with the rye corn, where it was terminated and then, you know, held over summer, kept the soil, allowed the summer rains to get in, and then went in with a strip till and cultivated and put
us in. And that's what we've done. I mean, we've just gone into the oat stubble pretty much with the strip till this year.
Yeah. Okay, there's no questions, so I'll just go back up to Michael. We won't forget you, but we'll come to you once we get onto the slugs and snails.
No worries. Thank you.
There's two Michaels. So we've now got Michael Evans from Mulgowie Farms. If you can whack him up into the panel, and we'll get Michael to talk in a minute. So I'll do Michael's introduction. I think he's in the vehicle, so I'm not sure what the audio would be like. But Michael's based down there at Mafra with Mulgowie Farms, predominantly a corn and beans production over summer, and then they cover crop over winter. So last year it was a cereal mix, so a bit of wheat, bit of oats. They did have some legumes in there, but it pretty much didn't come through. They were swamped out by the cereals. Have you found them? Okay, Adam, I'm going to go up to you and just ask the question of you know, what got you interested in strip till?
Initially, it was trying to get rid of all of these cover crops, and you know, we're working the ground many times, and when the conditions didn't quite suit, or we'd have a bit of a wet period, which we can do down here, we were struggling to work the crop into the ground and actually get rid of it so we could transplant, and just basically seeing what you guys have done with the soil wealth demo sites, and it just looked like something I thought that, you know, I could really use and benefit from. So initially we grow a lot of baby leaf on beds, and there's not really a great deal left after you harvest it, like you were saying before, and we're going and doing another 2-3 passes with bed formers and rotary hose and rippers, and just for almost nothing. So that little machine that you saw before, that was adapted, it's basically just a baby little rotary tiller, and I'm just hoeing strips through the harvested beds of baby leaf and transplanting our leeks and celery straight back into the bed, and really to cut out working, stop belting around the organic matter in the soil and losing it and holding the structure of the bed a bit better, as well as we have a fair weed seed bank in our soil, so every time you turn it over you tend to promote another germination of weeds. So by also not turning over more area of soil, we've been able to keep the weed populations down.
Yeah. I mean, I think you make a really good point there, Adam. I see it all the time with cover crops, you know, like growers, you know, you all like to grow things, really big ones. And so, like, you know, Jake's saying, you're growing 2-metre-high crops. Once you get around to incorporating that, there's a lot of organic matter incorporated in. And then sometimes I see the amount of tillage required to get it back to your seedbed for your cash crop is just excessive. And I shake my head and go, well, I reckon you're taking one step forward growing your cover crop and you're back out the back with two steps back through the amount of cultivation. So, you know, by combining that cover crop and the strip till, we try and sort of soften the tillage so we're putting it in and we're not losing it when we're doing that transition back.
Yeah.
Jake, just wondering what got you, you know, what sparked your interest in cover crops, but strip till. But before we do that, we've got a question for you. Why did you choose the time frame of 4 year in pasture, 1 year in veggies?
We wanted to stretch the rotation as long as possible. I suppose we've got the land there and we're all semi-permanent, so pull the main line to wherever we need to go, and we've got multiple pump sites across the farm. So just because we grow brassicas, club roots obviously our biggest issue, so the further we can stretch that rotation out, the better.
Yeah, so I'd categorise you as on the sort of broad acre end of veggie production. You know, you're
able to
pretty long rotations, you know, compared to Adam, then, you know, you're pretty intensive. So Jake, just in terms of strip till, you know, what sparked your interest in it?
I suppose soil health. Well, like I said before, it takes us to go from pasture to veggie ground up to 5-6 passes, go over with the mold disc a couple of times and rip it and then mold disc it again and get it all level, then transplant into it. By the end of it, like, soil's lost all its structure, and years following the veggie crop, it just sets like concrete. It's just rock hard and all the life's out of it. And so we sort of look for a way to get away from all that. So we came, well, I've met you and then sort of came up with strip till. So we decided to try it this year and it's been pretty good so far. Yeah. So, yeah.
Excellent. We'll come back to that.
Fuel savings as well. Bloody have been remarkable. I suppose. Yeah. Pull the multi disc and the deep rippers, you're looking at 25, 30 litres an hour versus a strip till at probably half that. So it all just adds up.
Yeah. Peter, what sparked your interest in strip till?
I'm one of those YouTube trawlers that just has basically seen every harvester in the world and every machine. I just spend hours and hours. I saw it quite a few years ago and I thought, oh, gee, I wonder if that could work, you know, in some of our crops. Obviously, same thing. Whenever we do grow either a cover crop of any sort, we're trying to smash up the ground, and we've got no organic matter up here in the Mallee Sand anyway. So I just seeing a few videos and then started seeing what you guys were doing. I've known Tim at Muddy River for 20 years, so I just rang him up and said, let's have a trial of this thing. And I was pretty convinced that we could just make it work straight up. So we jumped in and just bought a pair of machines and basically did the entire year straight up. I just figured if I messed around with it and trialed it too much, it'd take too long to get right. I just thought I'd just do the whole lot in one hit and I'll make it work as we go along.
Yeah. So this is your first cropping season with it too.
Yeah. And we've ended up with 120 acres sown down in one hit, over a few weeks. And we've made a few changes along the way, but we think we're pretty close now.
Yeah. Excellent. And I guess Adam, you've been doing strip till now for what?
Two or three years going around. Had some good successes and had a few disasters along the way as well, as I've sort of explained to you before. And one of those has been snails after a winter Rycorn crop that we've let get quite tall, getting up close to 2 metres. Basically just flailed off the right, sprayed it off with Roundup, flailed off the crop, cultivated some bare strips in to put our transplants in. And ended up with all sorts of slug damage, and that was with using slug bait as well. So we've still got a few things to learn in some areas about what crops to use and what when to have our rotations of cover crops and what to follow up after different cover crops.
Yeah. So Michael, I think that's your prompt to come in and talk.
So, as I said earlier, as you improve your soil, you improve water holding capacity. Slugs and snails need it, particularly in Adam's case with garden snails. They would have moved in from refuge areas, and he's actually created a refuge where they'll breed in his field. So under those high pressure situations, you're putting a lot of pressure on the bait. Traditional baits that you've used work where you've got cultivation, but where you're putting increased pressure on the chemical control because you've taken away a cultural control of the cultivation. You have to be a lot more proactive with your baiting, time of year, all those sorts of things become more important. So it highlights management's deficiencies where something previously was doing a job for you and now it's not. So particularly in rye and canola and those sorts of crops, they favour an increase in numbers of slugs and snails, and they like breeding in those crops. Beans is another one. So growing faba beans as a cover crop, be aware also of earwigs coming out of that. All those things can be controlled, as we suggested earlier, a use of a higher quality product with a higher loading of metaldehyde prior to putting your crop in would be important. So representing Agnova Metarex is one of those products. And also looking towards Europe and new products coming out of Europe and iron products that you can use in the row, in the strip row, again, to try and actually kill the snails. Because of course the biggest problem with vegetables is the acidic damage that's done. So it really does require a whole nother level of management as you move into cover crops. And we don't have enough information on what are the best crops to follow your cover crops or what cover crops could actually reduce snail numbers. But one suggestion I've had is actually looking more at flax or linseed, you might know it as one potential to put in there where you're putting a susceptible crop like celery in there. But again, Adam, I mean, how does flax grow in your part of the world?
Never actually tried it. So, it might be something to do a trial with.
Yeah. Michael, a lot of your, I imagine most of your work's in the broadacre sector where slugs and snails are a pretty serious issue, particularly down in South Australia.
Yeah, I worked at SARDI for 3 years and continuing trials in snail control, because snails in particular don't always damage the plant, but definitely are a contaminant at harvest time. And that's the issue that also faces the vegetable growers with consumer preferences for nil damage, which makes it very difficult to eliminate a pest from a farming system that encourages that pest. Mm. And I also do a lot of work with poppies down in Tasmania, which is a horticultural crop on broad scale. And down there, I mean, again, for them, it's more just keeping the slugs off the seedlings. So if you're dealing with slugs in a strip till situation, I think that's quite easy. I think the snails are more difficult, and also growing leafy veggie with contamination, slugs are quite easy to wash off, snails are quite easy to wash off, but the other one would be growing asparagus in a permanent situation in a longer rotation. Again, their damage to the spear creates a huge price penalty.
Is there any other pest and disease issues that you've seen pop up and when you've gone to strip till?
So the strip till, my main question still is, a project I'm working with is, does it increase pest pressures? And where you've got a lot of stubble, it does attract armyworm. And so particularly armyworm are pests of grasses. So growing corn into a rye corn situation, it may be a more attractive environment to armyworm. But then on the beneficial side of things, if you're growing lettuce into a lot of cover, it should reduce the ability for aphids to find the pest. So you may be able to reduce your insecticide usage. So there's lots of pros and cons we still really don't know about, but surely by improving the biology of your soil, and increasing earthworms and having a more stable system, you're going to eliminate some of those peaks and troughs that you see in the conventional system now, where you have something bare and nature just wants to fill that void, usually with pest species. So there's a lot of benefits once we get the tweaking right, but I think we're deficient in knowledge at the moment. So unfortunately, the farmers we have here today probably have more advice on other problems and issues that will come up are more knowledge intense, and we don't have that knowledge yet. So often the growers that are implementing this, like Peter going, right, we'll just make it work over the whole farm, he probably knows more about the problems and pros and cons of various pests than what I do.
Yeah. Thanks for that, Michael. We have seen up in Sydney last summer, we saw armyworms come in and being particularly bad after a oat cover crop. So we had a trial up there where we had oats on their own ryegrass, and then we had an oat ryegrass vetch mix, and the oat crop was a standout in terms of attracting the armyworms. But the yields were about the same as your fallow, whereas the other cover crops, you got about a 5 to 10% improvement in yield. So I think if we got on top of those armyworms, we would have been right. But yeah, there are some other pests. I wonder, Jake, Peter, have you seen any? And I'll just note if we do have a number of questions from the audience, but if there's anyone that's got has seen any pest issues, can you just type those in, and we might try and get you to, we might try and sort of bring those up as well. Jake, any issues with pests and diseases?
No, not so far. We're a little bit concerned with rhizoctonia, but haven't seen any of that. And in terms of slugs and snails, we don't generally have issues with it. Normally get a few slug issues on like fence lines and whatnot, where they obviously live in the grass on the side and come creeping in, but generally not an issue for us.
And Peter, have you seen anything up there?
No, we haven't. Although we didn't sow into a heavy oats crop either. We actually, I cheated a bit and I speed dissed it before we used the strip till, because I wanted a flat bed before we started. Our oat crop was quite up and down with the combine, it left it fairly rough. So we give it a really shallow speed disc, which chopped it up a little bit, but so there's still fallow there, but not great big lumps of it. We've got along as per normal.
Yeah, so the only one I've seen is the armyworms preceding the corn. The other one I did see a few years back out at Bathurst was in the no-till. We had a no-till treatment way back, you know, when we were out at just down the road at Lindenau with the no-till trial and the Bulmers. We had a similar one out at Bathurst. And we did notice with no-till, we seemed to get more club root. And we think it was something to do with the distribution of calcium and that around the roots there. But, you know, maybe strip till, we wouldn't see that because we're still getting that tillage to mix things in. so thanks for, in terms of other pests and disease, I mean, obviously cover crops have the ability to carry over some of the negatives, particularly in soil-borne diseases, and that's why I'm generally very cautious about mixes, because if you look at a mix that's got, you know, 4, 5, 6 species, you've generally got something that's in your rotation as well. You might have a brassica and then you're going into cabbages. You might have a legume and you're going into beans. So you just got to be really careful when you do go into mixes that you're not including something that's going to be in your crop rotation anyway. You just run the risk of breeding up those soil-borne diseases. I'm just trying to look through the questions. We've got a specific one here. I'm not sure whether you can answer it, Michael. Does Metarex have any effect on earwigs?
No, it doesn't. It's considered IPM compatible. Earwigs in your system are quite beneficial. Although they can cause a little bit of damage to seedlings, it's usually when the seedlings are under stress conditions. So my question back is, why would you want to be killing earwigs anyway? Metarex is very much IPM compatible and doesn't kill your predatory ground beetles or your predatory earwigs or any of those other beneficial species. That part of, I would have thought, strip tillage is trying to build up your bug numbers in your system anyway, so I wouldn't be particularly worried.
Right. I'll just get in there. We have earwigs are quite pests to the celery as well. They do get in and eat the stems and damage them. So we actually do bait our boundaries to stop them coming in.
Yeah. It's very interesting that there's one product that's been currently registered that contains fipronil, which will give limited control of earwigs. Again, I won't put you under any pressure. There was a product on the Australian market, Measurol, that was registered for use to control Portuguese millipedes. That's no longer on the market. So again, if we look at the way Europe's going, these broad spectrum type products are harder and harder to keep regulated. I think there is a deficiency there in understanding how we can actually keep earwigs off our celery doing damage without actually killing them. And I think if we could move down the biocide pathway and have a more sustainable system, and that's what strip tilling is doing, we don't have to kill things. I mean, at the end of the day, you just don't want them damaging your celery. Is that right, Adam?
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, Adam, you know, like in terms of your cropping system, your celery is your biggest challenge in terms of the strip till and the cover crops compared to your leeks. Leeks are fairly straightforward.
Yeah.
If I could prioritise strip till, then corn's the easiest one. Definitely corn, probably then brassicas after that, and then I'd be starting to look at your cucurbits, so your cucumbers, and that leads me into your pumpkins. Peter, have you had any, or do you expect to have any problems with cutworm in your pumpkins?
We haven't done any strip till with our pumpkins yet. Now that we've got the machine out, my son's been watching movies from America and looking at the way they roll there. Crimp roll their rye corn and sow into it. So yep. We're going to do a little hectare trial. I'm not convinced on how we'll go with weeds, but we're going to trial that September this year. We'll sow some, see what happens.
Have a chat to us. We did a similar thing out at Bathurst last winter into summer and going in with pumpkins. The problem we had mainly was the drought and the fact that the cover crop was pretty minimal. And then that flowed over, and then also there was no water in the Macquarie, so there was no irrigation of the pumpkins, so it was a bit of a loss. But we certainly learned some things, and I'll probably put you in contact with Mark, who was managing that side, around herbicides, and just being careful about roller crimping, because suddenly when you roller crimp your cover crop, you're covering your weeds, so your herbicides become a lot less effective. So you've actually got to think more about controlling your weeds right at the beginning of the cover crop so they don't establish, so that when you roll it, there's nothing there that will then continue on into your pumpkin crop. Just looking at the time, I guess it goes back to Adam. What crop have you tried, and where do you see the best fit?
So far, it's been with the leeks. The leeks have been really good, and that's after our either our rye corn or our baby leaf, strip tilling those. I did try that Orthomen machine on our beds, and I found it was too heavy, and it's really built for a heavy type soil and lots of bulky trash. So we've had to adapt smaller, lighter machines to keep our beds in good condition, I suppose. But you know, I'm really only just starting with it, so I think there's going to be I think we can get it right. It's just controlling these problems that pop their head up along the way, like the snails. And but I think for a soil health perspective, I think it's I've got to keep trying and get it right and overcome these small problems that you do have along the way. It's just, I think the biggest problem with it was we didn't foresee it, so we weren't on top of it early enough.
Yeah. Jake, I might thanks Adam. Jake, I might go to you in terms of the problem, little challenges you had in getting your strip till not so much working, but then integrating with your planting gear.
Yeah, now we had a fair few issues at the start. So, well, we found the strip till a lot, pulls all the top residue away, left a lot of root biomass in the till section, and all that was wrapped around the boot of the transplanter. So it wasn't burying the transplants properly. So we had a lot of issues with transplants sitting on top of the ground, and had a couple of people walk behind and just rebury transplants. So I think where we're going to fix it is we'll just have to put a straight disc in front of the boot just to help cut a line so that the boot doesn't have to wrap around all the residue.
And one of the issues we discussed, Jake, was the fact that you're not on GPS, so that there could easily be a bit of that you're not following right in the middle of the strip till area and just drifting a bit.
Yeah, I think that's also an issue. Obviously, where the shank goes, if you probably line the boot of the transplanter up perfect with that, you might have better success. But I think because the way of colders all mix it through and whatnot, I still think you need something on that boot just to stop the residue wrapping around it. Because, it causes issues with the crop, just variation with crop size.
Because that was the fear that Ed Fagan had out at Cowra with going in with the strip till and then direct seeding the cucumbers, but it worked a treat. There was no problems. And the McAuliffe's have been using it with a GPS and having no problems with getting their seedlings in the ground. Peter, I just wonder what your experience has been.
Yeah, I think I'm probably with Jake a bit. We weren't on GPS. We've never had GPS because I can drive straight, but my boys can't. So we've just put a GPS on one tractor, and we're probably still learning how to drive that, but it's on that. We've used that for the strip tilling, but not using it for our planting. And so we're relying on our guy to follow. And we haven't got beds this year. I've grown all our veggies on beds for years. And this year with the strip till, we're just on the flat ground. So the broccoli plant transplanting driver had nothing to follow. So he was relying on driving on flat ground and trying to keep everything straight. So that was a big one for us this year, and we probably will look at putting GPS on that planting tractor as well next year to follow straight. And then we probably did have a little bit of variation in our depth of planting too, which we sorted out. We sort of made the beds a bit harder. We put the rollers down a little bit at the back just to firm everything down a bit, but I still would like to improve the finish of the strip till before we plant transplants into it.
Yeah, okay.
Just on that, I think we found that if you transplant it when it's a little bit drier as well, the dirt seems to fall around the transplants a bit better. some of the times we had to do it after rain and it was a bit muddy and all that too, and it was too sticky. The dirt wouldn't fall around the transplants properly.
I'm not sure whether Michael Evans, are you online there?
Yeah, I am.
Michael, can I get you and then just get your thoughts on how you went for your strip till this year?
Yeah, okay, so with the strip till, it was our first year doing it. Like, for myself, we're a bit sceptical in it, but obviously knew we had to do some changes in the business, obviously, for farm health, and obviously cost reduction with the hope that strip till could deliver that. And I think with the help of yourself, Kelvin, we're able to get one of the Orphans down for a demo, and I think we ran it through a couple of different scenarios, and we're all quite blown away with how it could turn from cover crop straight into a plantable area. So with that in mind, I think we did half an hour demo and we purchased one. We plan to use it in our corn crop. And we did that. Once we had that online, we did all our corn, 200 hectares of it, straight up, which was successful. We got some good results there. Obviously, with our beans, I was a bit hesitant with beans because they're a bit more delicate. We did that through the hotter part of our summer, which we turned out not to be a hot part of summer. It turned out to be a severe amount of rain. So we had mixed results with strip till under beans, but some positives there that an area of land we lost beans to last year were actually able to achieve. But yeah, in corn, no adverse effects other than the slug pressure. Slugs was probably our biggest nemesis with strip till in corn. Outside of that, it was positive. We probably had on corn, I'd say there was more positives other than the slug pressures. In beans, I still think there's a lot of work to be done because we got wet conditions and that impact the beans, but outside of that, still positive.
So Michael, when we were driving around on the farm just before harvest, you noted how much more even the crop was when we drive down to those little dips. You weren't seeing a dip in the corn. Do you just want to sort of talk about that?
Yeah, so some of our blocks obviously slope up and down. There's some gullies and that through them. And that was probably, in my 17 years of growing corn, that's probably the most even I've seen. The corn did not differentiate in height through those gullies. And across our bed, the crops were a lot equal. And it blew me away too, because we hadn't done any bed formation from the harvest the year before. And our harvest went on our controlled traffic. So the ability of the strip till to but allowed the corn to be even right across, even with an uneven bed, was quite astonishing that we were able to deliver that.
And Adam, I think you mentioned the leeks. You saw a lot more evenness in the leeks.
Yeah, they were. And the other bonus was we had a lot less weed pressure because any weeds that were on that bed previously had been sort of knocked over and killed, and we hadn't returned the soil over to have a new generation of seed germinate, basically. So that, and the bed stayed it kept a lot more air in the bed as well, I felt. We dug a few holes in that inner, and it, you know, there was big holes in there where the worms were versus where we didn't do it. The soil was sort of dead and, just more waterlogged. So the crop was very good and very even in that area.
It's certainly the thing that I probably get, I hear the most when I go out and have a chat with the growers after they've gone strip till, is the evenness of crop. And I put that down to the fact that when you cultivate aggressively, like with a rotary hoe, you create a structure which is very unstable. And, you know, you've said it yourself, the bed slumping is a big issue. So when your bed slumps, you lose the oxygen out of it, it waterlogs, the plant just closes down. And so suddenly you get those dips, you just get crops getting really small, and it'll be the well-drained areas where they continue to grow. With the strip till, and if you go out with a spade, you can see it, the stability of the soil, the holes in the soil, you're creating the biology, creating the soil structure for you, which is able to withstand heavy rain and all sorts of other conditions. Jake, you know, you've had one go at strip till and you've been out there with a spade. What did you see?
Yeah, so we did earthworm counts in the strip till versus conventional. And the strip till averaged 25 worms in square foot versus conventional was about 2 or 3. So the amount of earthworm casters you find underneath the trash on the ground in the strip till stuff is amazing.
Yeah, and we've seen similar results. You know, if you have a fallow and then cultivate it, then one, you're not feeding the worms until you're chopping them up, so they're not real happy. If you put cover crops into the system, then you start to feed the worms, but then you cultivate it, you chop them up, so you'll sort of go up a bit. But if you combine both, if you have a cover crop and then strip till, the worm count goes up like this. It just skyrockets because one, you're feeding them, two, you're not chopping them up, and they're quite grateful for that. Look, I'm going to start wrapping it up, and I guess we've talked about some of the challenges around your machinery, around pests and diseases. And I guess if you can sort of have your thoughts on what sort of benefits do you think you're getting out of it? Sorry. In terms of, you know, diesel, timing, you know, those sorts of things. And I think, Jake, I might kick into you because you started talking about it earlier on.
Yeah, so the fuel savings, fuel and time are probably the two major savings we've seen. Just the little trials. I mean, it's one part, it's roll the cover crop and then strip till into it, sometimes spray it depending on the time of year, versus spray it off and then mold disc it a few times and deep rip it, then mold disc it again, just the transplant. So we're looking, yeah, probably half, if not more, the fuel costs. Versus, and time, we've got a whole worker who's now free to do other things, help us out, do other jobs. So yeah. I think irrigation will come down as well. But we haven't actually done too much on that because we had to irrigate it with the conventional. I think irrigation costs will come down. And yeah, the soil health, just a bit of structure.
Peter, what have you seen? And you know, you've been doing it a few months now.
Yeah, look, we noticed straight up the less water we've thrown on the baby transplants. We start in first week of Feb, so it's still really hot. And we would water 5 or 6 hours to work the ground because it's so hard. And then before we plant, we'd make up beds and then we'd have to give them 3 hours of water before we plant just to be able to keep things going. 45 minutes is all we needed on the strip till to keep it damp enough. In fact, the first planting were too wet. We had to wait a day because we'd overdone it. So that's one thing. One thing I did notice is like I'm with Adam, with the Ortham, and it's a big, heavy machine, and I had been speaking to Ben about his machines. I would still be looking at another option of a machine that's probably not so heavy and wide. We're only on 60-inch beds or 60-inch wheel centres, and so this machine, if we were to have beds, would just wreck them. But I'd rather have beds. That's what I'd rather have. So I think going forward, we'll look at perhaps having permanent beds, especially for the broccoli. But at the moment we've just changed a few things on the Ortham to try and have so it's not throwing so much dirt out the side, and I've narrowed the disc in as far as we can. One other point too is it doesn't work real well in wet soil either. We found if we pre-irrigate, because we've got to because the ground's so hard, but if we go in too early it won't work at all. So I get a bit nervous if we have a wet couple of weeks leading into it. If we're not organised in time, we could get caught out that way. But look, I'm with Jake here. Look, we went from 8 or 9 passes to 1 or 2. We were speed disc and a strip till plant. That's it. And the time saving, even doing a single bed at once instead of 3 beds with the bed former, was still astronomical. So we'll definitely be sticking at it for the broccoli.
Yep. Adam, what's your take on the benefits?
Same as Jake and Peter, really, Kelvin. It's the water holding capacity of the soil, the extra organic matter that you're keeping in there, the drainage as well, improved drainage, and then the fuel and time saving that, that go along with it. And probably really yet to see the full long-term benefits of it. I think it's more of a long-term accumulation of benefits that you're going to build up over years. And I'm looking forward to seeing, you know, how that comes along over the years now.
Yeah. Look, one, I asked the same question of Val and Sam after they'd been doing it for about a year, and they were, and I asked about fuel savings, what sort of fuel savings, and they were, you know, more than 30% reduction of fuel savings. But the two other things they came back at me without prompting was the number of tractor hours down. So the maintenance cost on their tractors, and they're looking now at, you know, their next tractor they buy will probably be a smaller tractor. And I think you've also mentioned it, time. You know, you've just freed up a whole lot of time. And Val was saying, I got more time to look at the crop and manage the crop. I'm not just out there banging the soil away with various implements. So they were the real standouts for me. And Michael, I'm not sure whether you're still there. Michael Evans?
Yeah, mate. Yep. Yeah, so to add to your list, I'd say some of our in-crop herbicides we saved on as well, especially in corn, we didn't have to do it. So that was a saving for us. Fuel for sure, time and labour. So to the other thing that was probably a big learning for us is understanding the right cover crop for us to strip till. The timing, moisture played a part, and as much as you said, I think it was too wet, you couldn't do it. We also found it was too dry, it didn't work as well. We had to find the right balance of moisture to actually go in and strip till. So that was another key learning from what we did as well. But like I said, we would, without a blink of an eye, with our corn program, we'll keep strip tilling. Beans, in the beans, we've still got a lot more to learn, I think, before we can say we're there. But overall, I think there's more, by continuing doing it, I think there's a lot more to gain in the soil health, which will change the ecosystem there too, which, who knows, it might grow up better and remove our slug pressures. But I think we need to stick out on our to see the gain down the track. And I don't think there's a silver bullet. There's still more work to be done, but very positive.
Thanks, Michael. Michael Nash, I'm just going to, you know, if you want to just sort of summarise where your thinking's at in terms of strip till and cover crops in terms of the pests and diseases.
I think it's fantastic that you're going to eventually, as Michael just said, create a more stable farming system, hopefully with less challenges to your crop. There will be these oddballs that turn up that will challenge your perseverance, and we don't always have the knowledge or the tools to protect your crop. I think Adam can account for that as well. But I think for, as markets require less and less residues and consumers want healthy product, which Australia's fantastic at producing, and particularly you growers are trying to extend the envelope, so your poor soils in Australia, you're trying to work with them and grow better soils and stick with it. Slugs and snails to me are an indicator that you're actually really looking after your soils. So I think you're doing a fantastic job. Stick with it.
Thanks, Michael. Look, I'm going to just wind it up with one last story from McAuliffe's. And in February, they had about 300 mil of rain up there. They had a cover crop in, the sorghum cover crop, and they needed to put their brassicas in. It was too wet to do anything. And after, you know, a little while after the rain, they decided, after mulching, spraying out and mulching their cover crop, they just went in and planted into that cover crop with no till at all. So they just basically went through with their planter and transplanted their brassica crop, and it looks fantastic. And it comes down to the fact that they looked after their soil, they've built it up so that it's got good structure, and it's repaid their investment by making it able to establish a crop under pretty trying conditions. So I think, you know, that's sort of what we're trying to get to, where our systems are just more robust and able to deliver. So I just want to thank the panel for sharing their experiences with us. This webinar will be as a recording now on the Soil Wealth website. There's a lot of information there in terms of both cover crops and strip till. Just have a look under the cover crops and biofumigant tab or the cultivation tab. That's pretty much up from us. Probably just a couple of additional things. I think there is still some opportunity if you're in the Gippsland area to get out there and have a look at the trial. That looks fantastic. And the last one is we do have a couple more webinars if you're not webinared out, and I'm certainly starting to feel that way. But we've got a potato irrigation one next Friday, and then on the 27th of May, Dr. Shane Powell from University of Tasmania will be talking about soil microbial communities. So looking at the DNA and you know what's actually in our soil and looking at what cover crops do. And I'll be talking about some of the experience we've had with mycorrhizal and looking across different vegetable crops and how we might manage it with cover crops. So thanks to everyone for joining, and thanks to the panel.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kelvin. I'm heading off to work.
Yeah, thanks, Peter. Thanks, Adam.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Michael, thanks, Jake.
Thank you.